Please stand as we pray this morning's liturgy together. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. The Lord is my portion, says my soul, therefore I will hope in him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. To sit alone in silence when the Lord has imposed it. To give one's cheek to the smiter and be filled with insults. Although he causes grief, he will have compassion according to the abundance of his steadfast love. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end.
Oh,
please be seated. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to New Philadelphia Moravian Church on this Sunday, June 30th. We are certainly glad you are here. And here are some items of news that will interest you. The first is that this Wednesday, the day before 4th of July, we will have open door lunch. So volunteers, watch for an email from me. And thank you to Jane Shore and helpers for hot dogs and an all-American meal that we will be sending out. If anyone is available on Tuesday morning for about an hour, I need four folks to help dress lambs. They are undressed right now, but there is a Lamb Sunday coming up later this month, and we want to have lambs available for you all to take out into the community. So maybe from 10 to 11 is kind of what I'm thinking. Let me know if you might be available for that. And last Sunday, you will remember that you learned of a young man who has received a leukemia diagnosis. And you learned about some very urgent financial needs of that young family. You'll remember that his wife has finished nursing school. She has a job that begins in July, but will not receive a paycheck until August. Again, urgent needs. Your generosity was immediate. Not only were we able to make the commitment for a mortgage payment and a couple of Duke Energy bills, but there is more good news. Because of your generosity, Cynthia was able to place a call to that family and ask this question: are there any other really anxiety-producing bills in the unpaid bill category? Well, their insurance is just barely under $1,000 a month. And so, because, again, of your response, we are able to cover their insurance bill for July and even into August to get them on firm footing again as they begin to work on their house following his cancer treatment. Thank you, everyone. Boy, I don't know when it's felt more like this is the church. Thanks.
Wow. I spent the last 2 days, well, Friday night and all day yesterday until late last night, at a men's spiritual retreat at Laurel Ridge. It was an enriching and inspiring experience. I got to lead the music and the worship gatherings, and there were about 40 men from some congregations here in Winston-Salem, some in Florida, some in Georgia. There were people who are originally from Antigua and from Jamaica and from St. Croix and from Suriname, and it was just a marvelous experience. Even just singing the blessing at breakfast time there in the dining hall at Laurel Ridge, that turned into a spiritual experience. But I got used to something over the last 2 days, and I got to warn you, I got used to when someone would say something that was praiseworthy, someone shouted, "Praise the Lord," and someone else said, "Amen." So I think after what we heard Clyde say, somebody's got to give a shout. Amen. For our time of prayer this morning, I'm going to read some words from the psalmist David, and then you can listen to those words, or some of those words being sung, and just continue in prayer as you listen to those words in musical form. From Psalm 51, "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you alone, have I sinned, and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence and blameless when you pass judgment. Indeed, I was born guilty, a sinner when my mother conceived me. You desire truth in the inward being. Therefore, teach me wisdom in my secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit. Then will I teach transgressors your ways, enemies and sinners will return to you.
Would our ushers please come forward for this morning's offering? Remember, folks, that we're always happy to have you place your tithes and offerings in the collection plates, but additionally, you may give securely online or always mail a check into our church office. And let's pray together. O most merciful and gracious God, from whose open hand we all have received much, we ask you to accept this offering of your people. Remember in your love those who have brought it, and remember also those persons and purposes for which it is given. Follow this sacrifice with your blessing, that it may promote peace and goodwill and advance the kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Ministry. We're changing the order of the songs, so the first one will be You Raise Me Up. This song reminds us of the many ways in which Evie has helped to raise the new Philly kids in a loving and caring environment.
The song also reminds us that God is always with us no matter where we are or where we go. God lifts us up and gives us strength, and God will continue to raise you up to all that you can be.
The other song we're singing is Friends. Evie, you know that you will always have friends here at New Philly, and we will always hold you and Dave in our hearts, and our hearts in big and small ways will keep the love that keeps us strong.
Troubles come and my heart burdened be.
silent until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. There is no life, a life without its hunger. Each restless heart beats slowly and perfectly.
When you come and I am filled with wonder, sometimes I think I've lived eternity.
You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up. Up the dreams, but planted.
sorry. I was caught up in the beautiful, melodious singing and playing of our teenagers. Weren't they wonderful? It was beautiful. Okay. Our gospel reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Mark. It's Mark chapter 5, verses 21 through 43. It goes like this. When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered around him, and he was by the lake. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue named Jairus came, and when he saw him, fell at his feet and begged him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live." So he went with him. And a large crowd followed him and pressed in on him. Now there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all that she had, and she was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. For she said, "If I but touch his clothes, I will be made well." Immediately her hemorrhages stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately aware that power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you? How can you say who touched me?" He looked all around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him, and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, some people came from the leader's house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any farther?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When he had entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. Then he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha, come," which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. She was 12 years of age. At this, they were overcome with amazement. He strictly ordered them that no one should know this and told them to give her something to eat.
Evie and I had some conversations about today, and she said, "Please don't make it a big emotional thing, because it's going to be very tough for me." So, Evie, just so you know, this hymn that we're going to sing as we lift our pack and go is not related to you leaving us. This hymn is being sung because we literally have some folks who are going to be lifting their packs and going up to mission camp this afternoon. And so we're going to commission that team. The hymn is not really that familiar. It's hymn 793, "When We Lift Our Pack and Go." So the choir is going to sing the first two verses. And while they're doing that, I would invite you, if you are one of the mission campers or one of the counselors, to come down and please bring this little paper with you when you come so that we can commission you hear. And the rest of us, let's stand and sing together, and we'll wait for the choir to sing the first two verses, please. Still getting used to this using the hymnal thing, but we are saving a lot of paper, so remember that. We have this commissioning liturgy, and I always like to call it co-missioning liturgy, reminding us that we're in this mission together, and we're sending these fine folks up to do some work in the communities surrounding Laurel Ridge. So please just follow the instructions on this prayer, and we'll pray together. Gracious God, it is because of our faith in you that we respond to your call to serve. The call to serve can at times be overwhelming. The need before us is more than one person can handle alone. Lord, we thank you for people whom you have joined together for your purpose. We thank you for those who are willing to step out in mission, your mission, our mission. We thank you for the Spirit of Christ that dwells in us and is always with us, here in this place or wherever we might be. Be with us, Lord. support them in our fast and prayers. Bless and keep us all, O God, in your grace. May we all be protected by your power, comforted by your love, and strengthened for witness and service to all of creation, in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord.
And it's time for children's message. Come on up, guys. Okay. We're going to set things up a bit here today. Okay, so Willow and Vivian and Lydia, will you get right there and stand on your knees? And Stella and Jack and Aelita, how about there on the second one? And you, actually, third one, you sit right there. You guys sit here. We'll see why in just a minute. So I have a couple things I brought with me today. One is a race car. If I put this race car right up here at the top of the ramp, what's going to happen? It's going to slide. Is it going to go slow? Fast. Come on up. Okay. I have one more thing, and then you're going to help me. Pastor Sam's going to help us here. Okay. We are on a roller coaster. Ready? Ready? Okay. You guys are on the roller coaster too. We're just in the front car. Okay? All right. You got to go with us. Here we go. We're going to go up. We're going to go. We're around the curve. Around the curve. Around the curve. Right here. Blowing in the wind. Okay. Here we go. Up, up. Hey, you guys are on the roller coaster. Help us out. We're going to the big hill. Wait. Oh my goodness, we're almost at the top. Wow, you guys are quiet on the roller coaster. Really? Are we on the big hill yet? Let's go on the big hill one more time because you guys didn't help. We're going up, slowing down, slowing down, chug. Okay, that's a little bit better. Okay, so here's my question. Or my thought. With each of these things, the match and the car and our roller coaster, each object, each thing had energy all stored up. It was waiting to be released. The car was ready at the top to zoom down the hill. The match was ready with a little bit of friction to make a fire and you can make some s'mores. And our roller coaster, when you chug, and you get right to the top of the hill and you're hanging there and you've got all that energy stored up and then you zoom down the hill. Did you know that we have power like that stored up inside of us, inside of each of us? You have that power all stored up. It can be used for all sorts of good things. So when we ask Jesus to come into our hearts, and then we ask Jesus to use us outside of the world so that everybody can be heard, can hear the gospel message, amazing things happen. So did you hear the story that Miss Evie read this morning? Jesus was walking through a town, and there was a crowd around him. And there was a woman, she had been sick and bleeding for years. And she believed that Jesus could heal her when nobody else could. Doctors had tried, people tried all kinds of things. Nothing worked, but she believed that Jesus could heal her. But she wasn't sure if she'd get a chance to talk to him, to get up, because it was a big crowd. And so she believed that if she just touched his clothes, that she would be healed. So, you know what? It worked. Jesus told her that because she believed released in her. And then Jesus went to the home of a man named Jairus, whose daughter was really, really, really sick. And Jesus told him, don't be afraid, only believe. Don't be afraid, only believe. And guess what? Jesus went into the room and he said, little girl, get up. And she did heal right there in front of him. If we believe in Jesus and we ask him to use us, that very same power is inside of us, inside of each of you, waiting to be released. And Jesus wants us to follow the same command that he gave those people. Don't be afraid. Only believe, and exciting things will happen. So now, I want you to grab your airplanes that you made. Jackie, grab one off the table. Don't worry, you're going to use it against me.
Before you go to children's kids worship, we got one song, and I think it would be great for the children to be in here. A little birdie told me that this is one of Evie's favorite camp songs, and you're going to have to help if you look in your bulletin. It's You Are Holy. When we start out, the women are going to be singing the lead, and the men are echoing, and you'll have some help because you've got the women in the choir and these youth here as well. We'll be echoing, and then the men sing the part in the left column, and the women just kind of listen in awe. And then we all sing at the end that all. Then the women sing the part on the right that says women, and the men are astounded at their abilities. And then down at the end, we sing where it says all. Here comes the great part. We do all of that together. The men are singing this part in this column, and the women are singing this column. Trust me, it works. And then we all end with, he's my Prince of Peace, and I will live my life for him. So let's stand and sing.
I'm gonna go get some more.
I knew you could do it. In our gospel reading last Sunday, we found Jesus and the disciples sailing to the other side of the lake, the Sea of Galilee. And they were in the midst of a terrible storm. It was a windstorm, and the crashing waves beat into the sides of the boat so that the boat was being swamped. Jesus was asleep, but the disciples woke him up, and he said, "Be silent, be still." And the wind ceased, and there was calm. But there would be more storms to come. Not with wind and rain and crashing waves. No, these storms would come in other forms. They would be different kinds of storms, different kinds of disturbances. Because remember, Jesus was taking the disciples to the other side. He had said to them, "Let us go across to the other side." And the other side was the region of the Gerasenes, sometimes called the Gadarenes, always thought of as those people. This was a Gentile area where no self-respecting Jewish rabbi would ever go. So crossing the lake, going to the other side, meant crossing social and religious boundaries, eating with unsuitable people, associating with the unclean, healing people at the wrong time and in the wrong way. The disciples must have been thinking, "He's taking this too far. He's already got us out here on the edge in Galilee, out of our comfort zones, and now this." Next thing you know, he'll be wanting us to go to Samaria with those people. But they went. You remember last Sunday, some of you, they went. The disciples trusted Jesus enough to go where he wanted to take them. It was going to be stormy, and what they would find on the other side might not be such a pretty sight. In fact, when they landed on the other side, we didn't hear this part of the story. It's right in between what we heard last week and what we heard today. But when they landed on the other side, they were met by a man who lived among the tombs and had an unclean spirit. And Jesus had a conversation with the demons. If you read that part of Matthew chapter 5, it's almost like something out of Stephen King. He had a conversation with the demons that were inside this man, and then made them come out and drove them into a herd of about 2,000 pigs, and the pigs went and drowned themselves in the sea. The disciples must have been thinking, "Good grief, we thought the storm was bad. We should have never let him bring us to the other side." Then today, our story began with the words, "When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered around him, and he was by the sea." But wait, I thought they were already on the other side. But now the side where they were when Jesus said, "Let us go to the other side," is the other side. Now, I'm going to blow your mind here, but if you think about it, if you're at the lake, you're always on the other side, and you're never on the other side. What? Bear with me. You see, if you're on this side, that side is the other side. And if you're on that side, then this side is the other side. No, whatever. It reminds me of what our dad used to like to say when we went on road trips. Of course, we would always ask that age-old question, "Are we there yet?" And Dad's answer would always be the same. Correct me if I'm wrong. We'd ask, "Are we there yet?" And he would say, "No, we're here. And we'll never be there. Because when we get there, we'll say, 'Here we are.' So really, we'll be here and not there yet." And you wonder how we turned out the way we did. But really, if we're there, then there is here, and here is now there. And if we're on the other side of the lake, and we want to come back to the side where we started out, then we're coming to the other side. Now, if you're confused, then I have succeeded in making my point this morning. Because the point that I want to make is that really from God's perspective, there is no other side. And there aren't these people and those people. Because as Paul wrote, there is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is neither male nor female. For you are all one in Christ Jesus. And as the song says, he's got the whole world in his hands. And another song says, Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. All are precious in his sight. We see in Mark's gospel that people on that other side are precious to Jesus. Precious enough for him to confront the evil that is destroying their life. And now we'll see that the people on this other side, even the children, are precious in Jesus' sight. Children weren't always considered precious in Jesus' time. On several occasions, the disciples tried to keep the children away from Jesus. But Jesus said, let the little children come unto me and forbid them not, for of such is the kingdom of heaven. And in our story this morning, Jesus shows us just how much he cares. When Jesus came back to this other side, a crowd gathered, a great crowd, and he was by the sea. And a man named Jairus, Abby and I had a conversation about Hebrew and Aramaic words and names before the service this morning, because we always anglicize them anyway, so it's anyone's guess. But in Hebrew, that would be Jairus. And by the way, that is a good Hebrew name, a Jewish name. So he was not one of those people. He was from this other side. In fact, he was a leader of the synagogue, a very important person. He was charged with correct administration of religious laws and the proper conducting of worship and religious practices. His decision to go to Jesus could not have been an easy one. This took place early in Jesus' ministry, but opposition was already mounting against Jesus, especially among the religious leaders. Jairus had probably heard about some of the questionable things that Jesus was doing, like healing on the Sabbath. And most recently, as I just said, going to the other side, that other side, and interacting with those people who had demons. Jairus had many reasons not to go to Jesus. But he had one compelling reason to go to him, his daughter. We don't know exactly what was wrong with her. They didn't know exactly what was wrong with her. But it was obvious that her condition was deteriorating rapidly. And she was 12 years old. And her father was afraid that she was going to die. And somehow he knew, that she would be precious in Jesus' sight. And that Jesus would heal her. And he did. But again, there were storms along the way. Storms of doubt and disbelief. And Jesus wanted them to replace their fear with faith. And he said, do not be afraid, only believe. And he went to Jairus' house. But along the way, he showed that we all are precious in his sight, by stopping to heal a woman who had been sick and suffering for as long as this child had been alive. And when they got to the house, Jesus went into the room and took the girl by the hand and said in her language, Aramaic, so that she could understand, Talitha kum, rise up. Not just be healed, no, more than that, rise up. Because that's what Jesus wants to do. He wants to raise people up, lift us up from the storms and the situations that torment us, and then raise us to new life in him. And he calls on us to carry on that ministry wherever we are. Now, you may have noticed that the closing hymn today is Bless All Those Who Nurture Children. And if you come here often or all the time, you also would realize that Evie would not be in here when we're singing that closing hymn about blessing those who nurture children. That's because this hymn is not just for her. It's for us. It's for all of us as we carry on together the work that she has been doing, especially while we find someone to step into that position. We're asking God to bless us as we do our part to nurture the children that God has placed in our midst and help to raise them up to all that they can be, to the life that Jesus offers all of us. Let's pray. God, we thank you for your presence again in storms, in conflicts, in difficult situations, in the challenges that we face in life. And we thank you for the way that you not only seek to heal us and restore us to what we were, but even to help lift us up and raise us up above to all that you know that we can be. Yes, we do thank you for Evie's ministry, and we will be able to thank her in other ways as well. But we thank you that you've raised up many people in this congregation who love children and who love to be part of what you want to do to bless everyone. The small children, the youth, the ones who are starting families, the ones who are in what we call middle age, and then ones who are, like me, advancing in years and looking back on all that you have been and done in our lives. We thank you for these ministries, and we pray your blessing on all of them. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And we're going to sing together, "Bless All Those Who Nurture Children." And the tune is Hymn to Joy. But if you've ever heard Hymn to Joy done by an orchestra, there's one part that's a little trickier than the way we normally sing it. And so don't think that you're getting it wrong. There's one part where you kind of jump into the next measure. Don't be surprised by that. The first time you might be, but I think it'll be wonderful. So let's stand and sing together.
Children sharing knowledge, showing love, who by faithful words and actions lead young lives to God above. Bless all those whose voice and presence deep devotion, dignity, motivate the church to reverence, guiding Christ from humility. Jesus, Lord, both by example and with words of lasting worth, Christ has given ways to sample hints of heaven here on earth. In the same way, Christian teachers follow through humanity, demonstrating in their witness glimpses of eternity. Bless these lives of dedication, days and seasons, weeks and years, spent in serving congregations, spreading joys and soothing tears. Bless these lives so firmly planted in the grace the Savior brings, flourishing as God has granted, soaring high on Spirit's wings.
As you know, we are all invited.
excited to go down to the Fellowship Hall for two events. One is the organizational event for these interest groups. You know, when Jesus saw that people were afraid, when they were afraid, he said, "Don't be afraid, just believe." And that kind of tells me that sometimes the opposite of fear can be belief or trust. Now, as we go down across to the other side here in the Fellowship Hall, some of us may be thinking, what exactly are we going into? What exactly is going to happen down there? These are, pardon the pun, but uncharted waters, because this is something new. And we're going to together see what God has in store. And we also have people there to help guide us through these activities. Following that, we're going to have the farewell luncheon for Evie and Dave. And I'm going to go ahead and tell you, since Evie's not in here, on the tables you will find some little bookmark pins and some little cards and some pens. And there is a Bible that's a children's Bible. And we're inviting you, as you're there at the table, just to write a little note to Evie. And then go find that Bible and use that little pin to pin your card onto one of the pages. Now, if you want to be really creative, you can think of a particular verse and go to that page and put it there, or just place it somewhere in the Bible, and we will be presenting this to Evie at the conclusion of that event. All clear, right? Just like this side and the other side. I lift a hand today, of course, for our dear Evie and for Dave as they go into this part of their journey. And I lift another hand for us as we try to continue the good work that has been begun by them. Receive the blessing of the Lord. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the community and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, both now and forevermore, in Jesus' name. Thank you.